Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to MoreShay with Marshay. My name is Marshay, and today's video is going to be about, are our lives a trauma response? Now, don't mind me, I have a cold, yes. I'm congested. But, are our lives a trauma response? And I believe so. Like, I'm sitting here driving, of course, and thinking. My brain is always going 100 miles per minute. And the crazy part that I'm thinking about is like a lot of the things that we do, a lot of the choices that we make are trauma responses, whether good, bad, or indifferent. And sometimes it leads us to make good decisions because we are having hope, but also precautious before just doing anything. And then at the same time, sometimes we are too guarded, or sometimes we are too standoffish, or sometimes we are too open to things because we feel like, oh, we've never seen hurt in that department. We've never seen neglect in that department. So to us, don't mind this navigation. Ooh, look at my mouth. I didn't even see that. But it's like sometimes we can use our past history in good ways and bad. Sometimes we could go against the grain and decide that we're never going to do what we've seen before, whether it was something not so pleasing. And then whether it was something great, like say your family was, you know, so kind, raised you well, taught you great ethics, morals, taught you great things, how to carry yourself, how to be as a person, and you carry those same things into your daily life, and you do the same thing when you have children, then wonderful. You're doing a great deed. Wonderful. But sometimes people decide that, oh, my life might have been great, because I've been hearing this lately. Like, normally I'm thinking, okay, when a person experiences certain things, I'm like, I already know automatically their childhood had to have a lot of missing points. And then recently I'm watching like a couple of videos where specifically two people that I could think of, one who did a 10-year bid in jail. She would always date men who were in prison. Well, yeah, her father was in the streets as well. But she was kind of telling the story of how her life, she grew up in private schools, but that don't always mean that you're not still having problems or issues or drama. That's the thing. That's the piece that people miss. I think a lot of the times people think, oh, if you have things that you need, you're not just lacking, like in material things, then you won't also suffer a life where you might chase a certain lifestyle that may not be for you. But she chased a certain lifestyle that was what she saw mimicked in her family as well. Her father was in that lifestyle as best as kept. And yeah, he may have done well to be able to provide for his family so that they can have everything that they need. But they also, in turn, taught her to date those same type of men, to be in those same type of relationships. Her child's father ended up passing away, and the whole nine. Did a 10-year bid, but she's fine. But the whole point is, you know, our lives mimic what we experienced in our childhood. And when I think about that, I get scared. Like, I don't know if it's just my overthinking mind, but I get scared because I don't want my life to mimic. And when I say mimic, it doesn't have to be exactly like your childhood, like everything that was done is going to be done to you. But a lot of the times, those generational traumas, like they said, there's also generational blessings. And some families are blessed for generations because of the prayers their grandmother prayed, because of the seeds their grandmother sowed. And so some people in their families, like, you'll see them continuously have great successes. And you'll be like, wow, this whole family is successful, whatever that determination could be for you, because success could mean so many things. It could mean wealth, it could mean happiness, it could mean love, it could mean they always getting married and happy in long-term relationships. It could mean they always have a bountiful amount of children who grow up and do well, whatever it is. Sometimes it carries throughout your genes, and a lot of the times if you really take the time to look at your life, yeah, it's a reflection of your childhood, and it could be good, bad, or indifferent. The choices you make, the decisions you make, I've talked about this so much, and it's a trauma response, because I try to make good decisions, but a lot of the decisions I'm making is based off of things that I've experienced, I've seen, and I know. That's all I could go off of. I could try to hear from other people and have hope and peace in place, and that's what I do as well. But with that, a lot of the times, these cars out here driving crazy, but with that, a lot of the times, I'm still in the back of my mind cautious, reminded of certain things that I'm like, I'm so cautious with my kid. Just to get to that point, I keep thinking. I'm like, why do I do the things I do with my child? Why is it that I just don't trust a lot of things, and I just don't feel comfortable with practically anything, and I'm scared for him to be certain places, and I know he'll have to grow up. Of course, that's life in the whole nine, and I don't want to fear it, because I often believe that the thing you fear most faces you. Let me tell y'all what my biggest fear is. My biggest fear I wrote about, like, everybody know I'm scared of dogs. That's one of my fears. But my biggest fear that I often wrote about, if I look back at my poems, I have a lot of parent fear. Like, I don't want to be the parent that, I don't want to be a parent that does not know how to be what my child needs, how to show up for my child in the best way possible, how to love them and support them through their best and worst times. That's one of my biggest goals. But through that, one of my biggest fears was to have a son. Like, if you read a lot of my poems, I wasn't lying in the poems where I said, you know, I fear a household with no father to raise. I can't even put the words together right. It's gonna mess it up. I wish I had it perfectly like it's written down. But it's something like, oh, I think I said, I fear the decisions I won't make right. I fear a household, I fear having a household with a father, without a father, something. I don't know. It's something to that degree of like, with my women capabilities, can I handle you? Basically, the poem is called Can I Handle You? If you have one of my books, if you don't, go get it. But it's called Can I Handle You? And basically, in that poem, I speak about, this is way before I ever got pregnant and knew anything about having a child. I was young as heck. But in my mind, I was thinking of, I always wanted girls because I wanted to show them a love that I feel people often show to their sons. Women, mothers, they often favor, love their sons, but I feel like with their daughters, they don't always get that same love and admiration. And I wanted to show that, hey, you can have a great, loving relationship with your daughters as well. So I always wanted daughters for that particular reason. But God decided to give me a son. And so with God giving me a son, I had a lot of fears and reservations, because I felt like, okay, if I have a daughter, my biggest fear of me being the parent to raise this child alone, I'm like, I feel like I probably can do it. I could try to raise her to the best of my abilities to be similar to me. And I don't think I'm terrible. I like me. Like, for the most part, I've made decisions that I could stand by. There are very few things that I did where it's like, I don't really agree with that. I don't like it. I don't know why I did it. But for the most part, the decisions that I make, I really can stand by. I'm like, okay, that's cool. That's me. But so when it came to having a son, I have so many fears, because with boys, I look at them differently. And I always think that, you know, there are certain things that they do that's just different, you know? And so, and I can't always understand a man's mindset, perspective, or whatever. And so I said in that poem, like, can I handle you? Like, I fear a household with no father in to raise my sons. Like, I fear the fact that I'm just like, the decisions that I won't make right, because it's like, I'll try to make the best decisions, and I'm hearing all these things about single mothers and single women and how their kids are, and I'm just like, they're just perpetuating fear in me even more, and I don't like that. Because at the same time, I'm trying to fight those odds by telling myself in my head, like, no, my son is different. I don't care what nobody says. I don't care what nobody thinks. I don't care what nobody feels. My son is different. My son is not that. My son will not. My son is not going to be what I've seen before. And the fear I have about how I view men and how I've seen men be, I'm just praying that my son isn't one of those men. That's one of my biggest fears, is like, God, please don't let my son be that man. I don't want my son to be like the men that I know before me. And not saying every man that I know is terrible, but it's just a lot of traits that I don't want my son to have. And so I'm just like, please don't let my son be like that. But I can't say these women always have all these traits that I want my son to have either, or my daughters to have either. So it's not like it was all these great, you know. Sometimes I feel like I may be one-sided, but no, that goes both ways. But with my sons, it was just, at least with my daughters, I felt like I could lead by example. with my sons, or with my son, I meant, not no sons. I don't know if I'm the example. I'm still gonna try my best to be the example, but I'm a woman. So he may look at it like it's different, you know? But yeah, that's just me. I'm always thinking, y'all. Think it's too hard, probably. But make sure you like, comment, and subscribe. This is MoreShay with MoreShay. And as always, I'll be back.